If you have siblings, like I do, you know that there are a number of things that you have in common. Some things are based on the environment you live and grew up in, and others are due to your genetics and traits that you inherited from your mama and your papa. However, while some traits are similar, there might be others that are different. But you both share the same ancestor in your parents. You also have other family members that share similar traits, like your cousins. However, these traits are not as similar to you as you are to your sibling. In this case, you share the same ancestor as your cousins. These are your grandparents. Even still, you have other cousins. Second cousins that you share some of the same genetic material and traits. You and your second cousins share an ancestor as well, your great-grandparents. We could even make a chart to represent this. In the middle diagram, you represent the letter D. Your siblings, they represent the letter C. The point where the lines converge? Well, that is your parents, which are your common ancestors. What would letter B represent? You got it. It represents your first cousins. At the point where line B converges, with the lines coming from C and D, this represents your grandparents. Your second cousins, well, that is letter A. And the point where all these lines converge are your great-grandparents. It's a simple analogy, but it's a good way to organize and classify things. As we learned in 5.3, biologists love to classify and organize and make sense of living things. So today, we are going to explore a related organizational strategy called cladistics. Welcome to 5.4, where you will learn many cool things about cladistics. The essential idea here is that the ancestry of groups of species can be deduced by comparing their base or amino acid sequences. At this point, you're probably like, but wait, Mr. O, we already studied the classification of organisms with our friend Carl Linnaeus and his binomial nomenclature. What are cladistics? Well, to recap, taxonomy is the study of classification of organisms, and binomial nomenclature is the system of naming a species. Cladistics, which is a part of the science of phylogeny, looks at the evolutionary relationships of these organisms. Taxonomists use phylogenetics in order to classify organisms, which traditionally looked at common characteristics and now utilizes genetic material to deduce evolutionary relationships. Make sense? Well, if not, that's okay for now. Let's dive in and make more sense about cladistics, cladograms, and explore a few examples. In the picture, we have some forky-looking things. These are cladograms. A cladogram is a tree diagram where each branch represents a splitting of two groups from a common ancestor. There are some important key terms that you need to know. These are node and clade. The point where two forks in the tree come together is a node. This point, the node, represents the point where these two now narrow species had a common ancestor. The other term is clade. A clade is all of the organisms that share a common ancestor and is usually denoted by highlighting a section of the cladogram. Let's examine the image on the bottom left so you can see the terminology in action. The point where each of the branches come together is the node. All of the organisms that share a common ancestor is a clade. Here are some examples of clades. You can see that they share a common ancestor at the node. You can also see that not clades, as they do not share a common ancestor. The fewer number of nodes between two groups, the more closely related the groups are. The point of cladograms is to show the probable sequence of divergence and demonstrate the likely evolutionary history of a group of related organisms from a common ancestor, which is a clade. In the example, we have three bird species. These species are related, and you can see the possible relationships in the three cladograms. This is a start, but how do we know which one is most likely the correct cladogram? We need to become Sherlock Holmes and gather evidence and clues. We can tie this back to topic 5.1, the evidence for evolution. You already know there is ample evidence for evolution, so phylogeneticists use the evidence, fossil records, comparative anatomy, embryology, and DNA to deduce the best possible cladogram. In the old days, this took a lot of time and effort on the part of people. There was little DNA evidence, and computers were slow and clunky. Now, much of the information is fed into computers that then analyze the biological data to create cladograms. This is just one more way that technology and science go hand in hand. Looking at this again, cladistics is another method of classifying organisms. Each clade consists of an ancestral organism and all of its evolutionary descendants. Members of a clade will possess common characteristics as a result of their shared evolutionary lineage. You can see examples of cladograms below. Note that they appear from top to bottom, and some look like branches, and others like diagonal forks. Either way is correct. You can even see them from right to left, or left to right. Whichever way they are, they represent a timeline as well. The end of the branch is current time, the furthest back is older. Let's explore an actual cladogram based on actual DNA evidence, where we even can produce an estimated timeline of divergence. I present to you a cladogram of primates. primates. You can see the relationship between different groups. On the y-axis, you see the timeline in millions of years ago. How do we know? Well, we know enough about DNA to know roughly how long it takes for changes in genetic code to occur, so we use our math skills. Whether or not it was 40 or 41 million years ago, it doesn't really matter. The point is to give you the general idea. So let's do some analysis of this cladogram. Humans are more related to chimpanzees than any other primates. They share a common ancestor, and that ancestor was roughly 5 million years ago. You can see that at the node. Chimps and humans also share a common ancestor with gorillas. That was around roughly 10 million years ago. So humans, chimps, and gorillas are in the same clade. Make more sense now? You can ask all sorts of analysis questions about this clade. For example, New World monkeys and humans share a common ancestor roughly how many years ago? If you said roughly 30 to 33 million years ago, that is correct. The common ancestor for all of the primates here was roughly 50 million years ago. You can see that in the node. So this brings me back to the substance, which is the rad concept that DNA mutations that occur and are inherited are predictable. Just like in the previous example, the mitochondrial DNA for primates has been sequenced base by base and is now used to create a cladogram. It's a molecular clock of sorts. It is predictable, and the idea is that the more closely related the two DNA sequences are, the more closely related the organisms are. The counter to that is if two DNA sequences are not as closely related, then more mutations have occurred, and the longer ago the two groups diverged. Before we had all of this wonderful DNA knowledge, similar characteristics were used. Remember that we have homologous characteristics and analogous characteristics. Homologous characteristics, as I hope you recall, are characteristics where there are similar structures based on a common ancestor, but the organisms have a different function. An example would be the whale fin and the human arm. These functions have diverged from the common ancestor they shared, but the structures are the same. On the other hand, an analogous trait is a characteristic that has a different structure but similar function. An example would be wings in insects and wings in birds and bats. These organisms did not share a common ancestor with wings, but instead, selective pressures over time caused these organisms to have traits that converged. This is important to note, as homologous and analogous traits can create headaches on how to organize and classify organisms without other evidence like DNA. As I mentioned before, technology and science go hand in hand. Historically, classification was done based on morphological differences, which are structural differences. Some challenges were things like adaptive radiation and convergent evolution. But now we have DNA, which along with the morphological differences has increased the efficiency and accuracy of cladistics. It is not the only evidence, however, and a scientist who only relied on one piece of evidence when others exist would be conducting silly science. A prime example that you need to be aware of are the reclassification of the figworts. Yes, the figworts. Until recently, figworts were the eighth largest family of flowering plants, which are angiosperms, and it contained 275 different genera. This was problematic, as many of the figwort plants were too dissimilar in structure to function as a meaningful grouping. Taxonomists examined the chloroplast gene in figworts and decided to split the figwort species into five different clades. Now, less than half of the species remain in the figwort family, which is now the 36th largest among angiosperms. This example is important to highlight, as it truly shows that science is constantly changing, and when more evidence presents itself, the responsible thing to do is use it and reclassify. In this case, genetic evidence from the chloroplast gene was used. We have already looked at a cladogram and analyzed it, but this is a skill that you must be able to do. You need to be able to analyze a cladogram and determine the evolutionary relationship between species, as well as discuss the use of cladograms as hypotheses of evolutionary relationships. So looking at this cladogram, we have four questions here. Let's go through them one by one. First up, what animal is most closely related to the squirrel? Pause the video here and try to figure it out. If you said guinea pig, you are correct. You can see that squirrels and guinea pigs share a common ancestor at the node and are therefore in the same clade. Next up, what animals are more closely related to humans than old world monkeys? Pause the video here and try to figure it out. If you said gibbons, orangutans, gorillas, bonobos, and common chimpanzees, then you are correct. This is because old world monkeys share a common ancestor with the others, but diverged from the common ancestor the earliest. They are all a part of the same clade, however. Next up, tarsiers share a common ancestor with which animals? Pause the video here and try to figure it out. If you said New World monkeys, Old World monkeys, gibbons, orangutans, gorillas, humans, bonobos, common chimpanzees, You got it. As you can see, they are all a part of the same clade, and their common ancestor is denoted at the node. Lastly, elephant shrews, elephants, manatee, and dugong all share a common ancestor. Which animal diverged from the ancestor first? Pause the video here and try to figure it out. If you said elephant shrews, then you are correct. These guys diverged from the common ancestor the earliest, and are in the same clade as the others. That's all I have to say about cladistics, and I hope that this video helped you to better understand what cladistics are, how they are used for evolutionary purposes, and how to analyze and discuss a cladogram. We will be practicing this more, as well as making our own cladogram from candy. So keep it real, keep on classifying, and bring out the inner taxonomist within you. As always, it's really important to give credit where it's due. While the presentation, script, and video are solely of my own creation, many of the images and information contained in the presentation are not. So shoutouts to the following. Most of the images and video clips come from IB BioNinja and some of the information used. Other images and info came from Bionology, iBiology, and Biology for Life. Lastly, some information was gleaned from the Cambridge edition of the IB Biology text. As the intended purpose of this presentation is to provide you with yet another resource tool to enhance your learning for the IB Biology curriculum. So stay woke.